Who's the most exciting person you've interviewed lately?
You guys, of course.
Oh, yeah. Right. Okay, what's the non-bullshit answer?
I mean, for real.
Let's just say I had to go into French bathtubs sideways.
Yeah. And I could barely fit in the French bathtub.
One time I got so wedged I was afraid we were going to need butter to get me out of the thing, you know.
Butter is very popular in France. So
yeah, there you go.
And in hot water, there could have been a chicken soup theme. We could have eaten for a week, right?
As long as it's not barbecue, you're okay.
Yeah, that's right.
So was this how you grew up?
Yes, yes.
Pretty much.
Me right here and them.
Yeah. Yeah, poor baby. You feel for him, don't you?
Yeah.
Were you always going to be an artist in this circle of fun? Or?
I don't know. I know it was at a family reunion. Actually, I think it was Nika's wedding where someone gave me a camcorder and I turned it into a movie. And I played it for them, and there was like genuine excitement about it, and I think I got the buzz then, and ever since I've been all about it. But I don't know. Did we?
I knew you were going to be a director.
Yeah.
We were on a road trip we were in the backseat of a van, he and I, and like he gave me a 15-minute dissertation about the directorial style of Batman movies. Mm-hmm. I'm like, Trey, I just watch Batman movies. I don't know. I'm not the person for you to talk to about whose directorial style I thought was better. So like, he's 6 years old, you know.
Yeah. So were you into Schumacher at that point? Yeah. Or were you Olive
Burton? I honestly don't even remember.
Yeah, see, now it's gone.
I have a feeling I was complaining about the Schumacher, but
I think you were.
I know that my like bread and butter was like that stuff and like James Cameron and Spielberg. But then I had a digital cable box in my room at too young of an age, and I saw stuff like
that makes me sound like a bad parent.
No, thank God I did. Yeah. I saw like Clockwork Orange and Boogie Nights and Raging Bull and like
you said 7 or 8.
Yeah,
oh, he was a little older.
I was older than that. I'm not sure how old I was, but there like Raging Bull was one I remember. I was like, this isn't Rocky, but I like it, but I don't know how I feel about it. And then like Clockwork Orange and Boogie Nights blew my mind because I kind of had an epiphany that like there's like one kind of genius behind this, you know. Before it was like I didn't understand. I didn't put it together that movies are like a real thing that get made, you know what I mean? But for whatever reason, those were the ones that first sparked it. And then, yeah, now those are the kind of movies I want to make, I think. So it's interesting.
Well, is that the kind of movie? I mean,
well, not necessarily. More, I guess, like auteur driven or like, right. You know, unique singular films. Like, I don't see myself trying to do like Spielberg type stuff.
Because this film gets the, you know, Cassavetes comparisons and all that.
Exactly. Well,
which is not exactly what Kubrick was doing.
Yes, exactly.
Or Scorsese.
Which is very funny. It's, and I love Cassavetes, but I think the funny thing, the movie's in certain ways made literally how Cassavetes made his films, but in other ways, like we shoot long choreographed takes with score, like stuff Cassavetes would never do.
Wouldn't do.
But I hope that, I love the comparisons because I think his movies have so much soul, and I hope some of that soul comes across in the end movie, you know.
So was it easy to be directed by him?
Incredibly easy.
Yeah, and it didn't even really feel, I mean, he said earlier today in something, it didn't even really feel like he was directing us because it was so just organic.
Yep. Well, you get shorthand.
Collaborative.
You get shorthand. We have it in our family. You know, there's like buzz things. And like for he and I, from the very first time we worked together, I have a tendency to be big. I feel big. I gesture
big. Big.
I'm big.
Yeah.
And so we did a dial thing. Up or down. And I mean, like, after a take, a very complicated take with a lot of dialogue or a lot of whatever, all you would usually have to do was...
For the feature version, I didn't have to do that very much.
No, we did
just
it in
a
couple
short. Times, yeah. maybe. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, and there was blocking always. Like, he would tell us, you know, kind of, we'd have an idea of kind of what he wanted to happen, but it was so... He was so willing to let everybody kind of feel their way through. There was never a time where it was like, oh, I wasn't supposed to do that.
You know,
I mean, it was so natural.
Which is so ironic because I've worked for first-time directors who are so unsure of exactly what they want to do next or how they want to do it. And here he was. I felt like he was watching the movie in his head. while he was shooting it. He was already seeing it finished, and yet he wasn't rigid.
Not at all.
About telling us what he wanted.
Not at all. That was cool.
Well, that's it. I mean, it turned into a beautiful way of working, because I think the end movie is probably 70% scripted, 30% improvised, and every day we'd get what we had to get in the script, you know, to really tell the story, and then, you know, the rest of the day, different actors, I keep saying this, but different actors would be in different parts of the, different rooms in the house creating scenes, and we'd go out and shoot those. Like, everything between Krisha and Bill Wise, this great actor, on the porch, when they're going at each other, that's 100% improvised. You know, it was a really beautiful way of working, and I remember the first time I was editing it, I was high, like I couldn't stop, because it was like for the first time pulling off the vision, what I really hoped to get. But on top of that, it was so much more. It was stuff these other people contributed that I could have never thought of, you know.
Yeah.
It was really beautiful.
And so, because our mom has dementia, you know, there was an element of we had to be completely spontaneous whenever she was involved.
Yeah.
We didn't know what she would say. So before she was ever in, like the first scene where she's in the movie, Trey was like, we're going to have to just go with it and go with what she says. And we might try to lead her, but you never know.
Yeah.
She could talk about, you know, she said some real, remember when the mic was down and she made some phallic reference to the mic?
That was when we shot the short.
You never know what our mom will say.
Yeah. Well, when we shot the short film, we had a similar scene in the short film version, and we bring her out. She does this whole scene, and we're like, this is going great. And then at the end, she like turns and sees my DP hiding under a blanket across the house. And she's like, I see you. It's like she pulls it together all of a sudden.
But she was word salad earlier in that day.
Yeah.
She was total word salad.
Yep.
So we were so grateful when the movie, the take we used where she started talking about her mother. So it was really cool. So that also added to the had to be spontaneous thing.
Yeah.
And the other thing that was fun about it, and easy, is that because we were living family style in the house, and his girlfriend and her mother were the caterers, and I made the coffee in the morning, and it was like we all became a family. And then you're like, it was like we were at camp, and we were gonna make a movie.
Kids were sleeping on the floor.
Everywhere.
And he just trusted everybody to bring it. It's like, bring it. And then we kept hearing people say, you know, I was not certain about this, but people decided, made a conscious choice to bring their A game. It's like you could see these people who were like, yeah, a little indie film, who knows.
Yeah, but boom. It was almost, we knew everyone except a couple of people, know? So,
but
like, after the first day, we all felt like a family, or at least I did.
Yeah, but
some of the people that didn't know us, they were like, you know, I wasn't so sure about this, and then I see, you know, and I'm not an actor, and it, you know, it's his family, and they were really...
Well, it sounds far-fetched. Like,
it sounds like, how's this going to be any good, you know?
Somebody asked me the other day in an interview, like, you know, what about this whole thing working with your family? You know, what's that like? And I went, well, it seems like it works pretty well for the Coen brothers. you know, I'm like, why would it be... there's a long history of families doing creative work together, long history. You know, just because we all came from out of nowhere doesn't mean that we weren't bringing our own special gifts and talents and collaborating in something that would be that real.
You were the Marx Brothers.
Marx Brothers making a light little movie about addiction.
They toured together on
absolutely
on vaudeville and did everything before they ever made a movie. Every movie was, you know, out doing it in theaters over and over and over again before they figured out what they're going to do.
Yeah.
So where did you start? What was the first inkling of this idea of doing this?
I think it was, it was a combination of factors, but I think the big thing was Nika, what happened with my cousin. We had a family reunion, and we thought she was sober, or she had been sober.
For
5 years, and she relapsed, and 2 months later she overdosed and passed away. So I think it was processing that, and then combined with the fact that I always wanted to write a great role for Krisha. I always had this fantasy notion that my family would actually star in the movie too. It was processing stuff with my dad. Our relationship was very much like the one my character had with Krisha in the film.
His biological dad.
Biological father. Yes.
Yeah. So are you? I mean, were you before that? Were you wanting to escape to L.A. or New York or something?
No. Well, that's actually a whole long story, because when I was 19, I was it was after a semester, my first year, freshman year of college, I went to, Krisha was living in Hawaii, and I was interning on commercials and stuff with the people she knew. Really long story short, I lucked out and got on a Terrence Malick movie, and I was just an intern, and it was a small, it was basically second unit footage that you saw in Tree of Life, and he's still going to put out Voyage of Time. Long story short, the first AC had to leave because we were filming a volcano and it was being weird with the eruptions, and then the film loader first stepped up and he taught me how to load film mags, and then I was loading IMAX film, and the first time I was doing it, outside of practicing in my hotel room, lava was flowing at us and it was raining and someone was holding a tarp.
Trial by fire for real.
The DP is like, I need another mag. And, but I did okay, and he got me on all the other shoots. So I decided I'm not going back to school, and yeah. I traveled to like Iceland and Chile and Monterey and Utah. And I did that for a bit.
Terry.
Not with Terry. Okay. Terry came
for Terry,
basically. Terry came to a couple of them, like he was at Redwoods.
But the strings brought you back to Texas.
Yes, yeah. And then I ended up coming back home. Terry's in Austin. Mm-hmm. I did some interning there. I worked on the movie they shot there and the Jeff Nichols movie a little bit. And when I wasn't doing that, I was working for my dad at our house and obsessing over movies.
Yeah, just trying to make a little money.
Oh my so God, he would spend
watch for hours and
movies
hours
and movies
hours.
And movies, yeah. And he'd watch it first, and then he'd watch it with the director's commentary, and then he'd watch it a third time.
Yeah.
And you know, he was incredibly and he did this beautiful thing where when the moment something clicked inside his head and he knew that he was actually going to be making films, the grandkids were at the house one time, and he said, I'm going to replace all of my DVDs with Blu-rays. Here, would you like DVDs? And they're like, yeah. And Israel scored like, I don't know, 30 movies. He comes in, he's got this stack of movies. He's holding them like this, Trey gave me these. You know? So yeah, that was film school.
Yeah, that was his film school.
Well, studying movies and then making shorts, which y'all did with me, and like just trying to find my voice as a filmmaker, you know?
Well, and Terry and Jeff as guidance, obviously they're the biggest pricks in the film business, so we learned what it was to have a brutal set and unhappy.
Oh, you know it.
Yeah. And he was loyal. Hell on us. Oh, you know my God, yeah.
He's loyal to them at all. Yeah. Nobody cares about them.
Yeah.
No, I mean, that's the thing, like, they're great people and great guys, and you know, it was inspiring, and it's cool too. Actually, the stuff I worked with Jeff wasn't, it was just pre-production testing and stuff, so it wasn't even an official shoot. So I never actually have worked on a traditional film set, which is really interesting. Like, Terry's sets are not traditional at all.
That's true.
Ours
was not.
In a way, a mix of traditional and a lot of not.
You have something to look forward to.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I mean, do you look forward to that, or is this a form that you plan on repeating?
I definitely plan on repeating the nailing what you have to get in the script and then collaborating and creating stuff. In my next movie that I'm doing, it's harder because the script's a little more dense and there's not as much room for that, but I still want to make room for that because it's a really fun way of working. And just being open to, collaborating with actors even more in the particular scene you have and how you can make it even better than what's on the page.
But we don't get to work with him again until his fourth film.
Or third. I don't know.
Well, third or fourth, and it's only because the pictures that we have of him as a child dressed up.
Oh, he dressed in drag. Like, we have some great shots.
Like Carmen Miranda.
Yeah. We have a guinea pig book.
And we really thought that they would be better blackmail stuff, but apparently he doesn't really care if we out him for all this.
He has this great writer here. He wrote a guinea pig book when he was in first grade. Hysterical. He misspells every single word. Guinea pigs can't read books. Guinea pigs are not. Nice.
So when we got to LA, I posted on Facebook a picture of a guinea pig in a sombrero. And it says, sometimes guinea pigs write movies.
Yeah, they're not movies. It's a sombrero guinea pig.
So true.
We don't cut him any slack.
So we're gonna,
I get that feeling.
Yeah.
And you're used to it already.
I'm used to it. Are you kidding?
Oh, he could deal with anything.
Yeah.
That's right. He'll never complain about a difficult actress.
Never.
Yeah.
That's right.
You're not giving me shit. Do you not like me?
Until he marries one of
them. Yeah, there you go.
So when you first wrote this script,
yes.
Was it, when you guys read it, was it shocking? Was it surprising?
Yeah, how was, and it's changed since that first draft with the short.
Okay, I will tell you what was shocking to me about it. That is that this guy had been kind of monosyllabic. For a lot of his life, he was a guy who had everything inside of his head, and he kind of didn't bother to share all the long versions of things with people. So it was like you'd write him like a 7-page email, and you'd get back, okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Which part?
of still seven like pages that,
was fine.
Extent.
No, what was shocking to me was that the minute he started watching films and studying them, he spoke a new language. And when he wrote that script, it was so eloquent and so succinct, but so completely a whole movie that I saw from start to finish. And I was primarily first shocked that, you know, The Quiet Boy, that he had brought that many words onto paper and explained his vision that clearly. It was not shocking that he would do it because we were a family that always talked about our feelings. Yeah. Robyn and his stepdad are both therapists. We're
therapists. And so, you know, he grew up in a very open home. But I will say, for me, I would say the only thing that, because I'm a therapist, and so yes, I practice that in my life, but I'm not so used to airing all of our personal issues. And it was a little bit conflictual for me, and I told Trey that because in my work, I can't really do that so much. And I had a little bit of, like, just anxiety about that and a little bit of angst. I mean, we even, in the car on the way to South by Southwest, when we don't know how this is going to be received.
Yeah.
We had this whole conversation. Krisha and I were driving together. We called Trey. We're like, well, are we going to tell everybody everything? Yeah.
That this is real?
Our niece's death, yeah. about his biological father, about the fact that our mother was an alcoholic late onset, not yeah. young, when we were young. And we just said, Trey said, no, we're going to tell the truth. And I was like, yeah, we are. And once I saw the reaction, the first screening, the way people were touched, yeah. I was like, this is so incredible.
That was one of the best days of my life.
It easily. Was one of the best. I sat there with just a sense of peace, like, yeah. okay, we've done something really good, and it is going to touch people in a raw way, and I don't care what yeah. anybody thinks about us or our family, because it's in everybody's family. It's just people aren't willing to talk about it and yeah. expose it. So that was my only concern. I thought the script was great. I was just kind of like, we're really going to do this.
So does it feel like your family when you watch this, or does it feel like a...
It's a blend.
Yeah it definitely is.
In the end, it is a narrative. It's not nothing as it happened.
It's not truth.
But, I mean, to speak for myself, I just feel like our experience and emotions come through it so much that it does, but at the same time, it is a narrative. I don't know. I don't know how y'all feel.
I would say, really? Yes, absolutely. I would say that the ways in which it feels like our family is when you see the spontaneous love, when you're watching people hug each other and tease each other and play together and be honest and raw and about emotions together. But we less frequently had the stranger that my character is present in that awkward a time or place. That what feels different from our family is the awkwardness and the hesitation to love.
Yeah.
What feels like our family is the willingness to accept and love and forgive. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely not the story. I mean, I'm not the person it's about, and it's not about any of those people. It's about
it's the culmination of things.
It's like addiction is like a storm that you see coming, and then when it's in your proximity, and then when you're a family and you have somebody who has become an addict or an alcoholic, you're constantly opening the door to the storm. It's like you have a safe haven. And you go over and open the door to your house and invite it in lovingly in the hopes that the love will calm the storm down and then you'll all get to watch a beautiful sunset together. You know, and you never know what's going to happen because it's not in your hands. It's in the hands of the addict or the alcoholic and how their path is about to change all of your paths. So that's the way in which he took a kernel of what we experienced and he dramatized it into these events. This is not what happened in our family.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
This is how it felt.
Yeah.
Yeah, parts of it. Yeah.
Were your childhoods like this?
No.
Like his childhood?
Not at all. Yeah. Oh, you mean his real childhood?
Well, no, his real childhood. I apparently grew up amongst this family of people who were, I don't know if hippie is the right word, but there, it sounds like a kind of like an open love, kind of like a definitely a 60s vibe.
No, we were, I would say our parents were the classic World War II survivors. We're going to build freeways. We're going to have supermarkets. We're going to have frozen food. We're going to make life easy for our children. Our children are all going to go to college. And without realizing it, there was everything was laid on for us, but there was also expectational stuff that we didn't want to step into. So after we had rebelled, all three of us in our own way, the girls, we all in our own way lovingly rebelled from the stricture of the straits. Our family were straights, and we all kind of became not straights so much, and we raised our children not straights because we wanted openness, we wanted honesty and stuff like that. So our childhood was very, your hair had to be in ringlets, I had to wear white socks, I was the white socks and the white gloves, and our grandmother put us in girdles from the moment that we, you know,
girdles.
Yeah, girdles and ironclad bras and, you know, all of that stuff. I was very,
she was Camp Sunshine.
I'm about to blow your mind.
She was.
I was very religious.
She was Camp Sunshine Queen
Miss
or something
Camp
or other.
Sunset.
I'm sorry, Miss Camp Sunset.
The woman, the girl who most exemplified Christian ideals.
Now, it's not a joke.
Now, and but you know what? Here inside, I knew it wasn't really true. Because when the minister came up to me and he said to me, "You're such a fine Christian. I know that someday you'll be a deacon's wife." In the back of my mind, I went, "Why not a preacher, you son of a bitch? A deacon? I'm only worth a deacon?
Yeah.
Deacon's wife.
Yeah.
Not even a deacon.
Yeah, well, how about I be the deacon?" You know, I mean, and when those things rose up in me, it was like, oh, yeah, maybe this whole Christian. The Christian thing kept me out of the back seats of cars. It did. It kept me non-pregnant. Until I could get out and get on my own and become a liberated woman. And Robyn was watching that. She was 8 years younger than me. Our oldest sister, Vicky, was a big time hippie.
Big rebel.
So no, our childhood was very different. We had to fight for our freedom.
So you seem pretty Christian in spirit.
Yes,
not,
we
I
are.
I am.
I am a very Christian spiritual person.
I'm a very spiritual.
Not really spiritual.
I'm a humanist. A spiritual humanist. That's who we all are. We're very in touch with that side of ourselves now. Mm-hmm. What the rigidity was what didn't work for us.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know.
So what was it like growing up in the middle of all that?
I mean, it was great. I don't know. I love it.
You got a cable box out of it.
Yeah, exactly. Got a cable
box. And a lot
box.
Of great Blu-rays.
Exactly.
Well, I spent a lot of my childhood at Pee Wee Acres, my grandparents' house. And in my memory, it's like beautiful, happy, fun family.
It was. We did.
And
we'd get chickens. He'd go out with in the morning with Gigi and get fresh chickens, eggs from the chickens.
And remember, every Easter we'd go to the country and do the eggs. We had, when the children in the family were growing up, we gave them more of the childhood that we wished that we had. We gave them unconditional love. Our father was a post-traumatic stress. Nobody knew the thing
World
at
War
the time.
II guy.
He was very emotionally withholding. The unpleasable male prototype for all of us, and we've certainly fallen in love with many of them until we healed ourselves of that. our mother was the loving, perfect mother. The Stepford little perfect, everything was ironed. She ironed our father's underwear at 6 a.m.
She did.
You know,
handkerchiefs.
So we gave these kids trips to the ranch. Robyn would drive up to the ranch, and the first car that had a sunroof. Before Trey would hang out the window of the car.
When we got to the gravel road, I would let him put his head out, and my dad would be going, "You can't let him do that. He's gonna get a rock in his eye."
Yeah.
A lot of dogs, a lot of noise, a lot of fun,
horses.
A lot of music. Our father loved music.
We played games.
We did this. Every Christmas holiday, because my birthday's Christmas Eve, so the family was all together. I'm 65 years old. I've spent exactly 2 birthdays in my life not with my family.
Awesome.
What a gift that is, right? You don't get to do that when you grow up. And then every summer, no matter where the rest of us were in the world, we'd spend a few weeks together. And we have kept that up with Nika's children. Nika left 3 children, and we made sure, even though they were being raised by their father's families and I raised one of them, we made sure that those family reunions continued. Mm-hmm. And that was, I think, part of where he gets this. I mean, he's for a guy his age, he's very unabashed about admitting his emotional connection to his family, mm-hmm. and that he cries when he's editing, and that he, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. that I think was an offshoot of that hippie love, peace generation kind of parenting.
So what was it like when you showed the short for the first time? Were you scared? Oh,
yeah, I was very...
Did you show it to everybody already, or were they there for the first...
I think the first time... Didn't I show it to you at Vicky's?
And we saw a rough computer? Cut. We
well,
saw
I'd a rough cut, yeah. I'd seen it, but we didn't see it to the feature. Family.
Yeah.
Until we saw it in the theater
at South by. Yeah. Yeah, I'd seen it on the computer at home, but I think Dad and I were the only two that saw it before that.
Yep.
Well, we were scared to death, right? You were scared.
I was scared to show you all the short for sure because I didn't know how you'd respond. And Vicky, it was traumatic for her, but you know, in a good way, like a cathartic way. And then premiering the feature at South by was cool. A little nerve-wracking, but I don't know. It turned out...
We had no expectations.
It was very cathartic.
I mean, we went there with... Maybe some people would come see it.
Yeah.
And maybe some people
No one knew about our movie or...
Like, yeah, we had no publicity.
We had nothing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
No. You do.
And we had like what... I mean, our first screening, it was half empty. Yeah. I mean, there was like hardly anybody.
It was a decent turnout.
Every time we'd have another screening, it was more full.
Yeah.
You know, as the buzz was getting around. And then once we won, and then they added like 8 more screenings, and then they were like packed.
But
and
the
it was
half
amazing.
Full audience of the first screening
went out and told people.
Well, no, but even before that, they were stunned.
Oh, they were moved by it.
Yeah.
When the Q&A was ready to start, we looked out at an ocean of stunned, emotionally involved humans who we had a guy who I won't out him by name come up and collapse at the edge of the stage sobbing onto his arms, a guy in the business,
yeah,
who I now call Crying Man.
Did he buy the movie?
No. And it was because his mother had has dementia,
yeah,
and Alzheimer's, and that's the other thing, is that the family thing goes further than the addiction thing.
Yeah.
The family thing is everybody has a family. Everybody has ways they feel about young couples and young couples with babies and sisters,
yeah,
and people raising other people's children and, yeah, and all of that, you know. So no, we were so grateful that people got what the intent had been,
yeah,
when they saw it.
I think whatever it was too, yeah, like just Austin, maybe, like that was the right crowd, you know, because it's not a movie for everyone. There's people that won't be touched by it at all or think it's weird.
Have you found
but
that?
Yeah, definitely. I've had audience members that just like don't seem into it at all, and it's interesting too, traveling the world with it in different cultures and how they perceive it. But yeah, I think South by was perfect.
So when they said come to France, was that like, oh yeah, of course, that's pretty normal.
He thought it was a joke. He called me and I said, okay, come on.
I didn't
there was
even...
somebody doing a fake French accent. Did you look at the number? Was it even a French area code? You know, come on, seriously.
I didn't even submit. We missed the deadline and we won South by, and then our guy that came on as our publicist after that, Adam, was like forcing me to like fill out custom forms and send the Blu-rays and everything. I'm happy I did because it worked out. I just never thought we could play there.
I have the envelope that you sent that original Blu-ray in that he
really?
Returned it in. I've kept it.
The DVD?
Yeah.
That was the Fortnite's DVD. They never got it. It got lost in the mail. The Critics Week got theirs. That's what matters.
Yeah.
And so what was that whole experience like?
I mean, I thought that, well, we got all of us there for starters. We got like 15
got
of us.
And
I mean, we met you briefly there.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was surreal. So South by was surreal just because we had no idea how it would be perceived. And
yeah,
then it was a whirlwind when everyone started digging it. But then Cannes was more of a celebration. You know, at that point, it's like we got over the jitters for that. Even though our premiere, I was terrified. I was fine for the first half of the movie because there's some humor and stuff, but then when that stops, it's always dead quiet. And then I started freaking myself out. I was like, they hate it. They're going to boo.
Well, in the translation thing, we weren't sure, you know, quite how that was going to go.
Humor and stuff does get lost in translation,
too. Well, you
were
in the south of France. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Great.
But then there were people, we went out in the suburbs to do a screening, and there was a woman in the front row that was like very offended by my character, and she was so passionate about it.
On you.
She was like, she had her cane.
She was trying to hit her.
Right where you are.
Yeah,
he
was trying
and
to hit her.
I can't speak French. Cane on the thing. And,
yep.
and Trey's like, she's an actress. She's really nice. And I'm like, I love her. This was a movie.
Yeah.
So that was really interesting. We found a lot more people in France kind of not, I guess, not understanding the boundary setting and stuff and feeling like
they were
too rejecting, and
they were passionate about Krisha.
Awesome.
They're like, you never turn your back
on
family.
You should have been more, you know, supportive and all that.
They
so
were,
that was interesting.
They
was
were really empathetic with canes.
Yeah.
So.
And empathetic and dangerous.
And dangerous.
Yeah. And was it fun?
Oh, so fun. You know, we stayed in a house. It was so fun. Yep. I mean, Trey wasn't in it because he was in a big hotel. Krisha and I, with all the kids, we shared this beautiful little house up in the hill.
And we would come down.
Dustin and his brother,
we
John.
We would come down every morning, and they would have been out late. We were little old ladies. We'd been to bed early. We'd come down and make coffee. Because we knew they were all going to screenings. And they're tuxedos.
We're all hanging on the stairway.
We hung all our badges from the stairs. All the badges were hanging there.
Running to screenings and tuxes.
Their tuxes smelled so bad. They were never washing their shirts. Yeah. You know, and we went to the grocery store and we got a lot of water and fruit and coffee and everything for all the kids.
It was like reliving the filming.
It was funny too.
And we walked on the Quasette down to the pavilion every day. And then we walked back at the end of parties. Robyn and I would find ourselves, you know, at 2 a.m, like out on the smoky dance floors, boogieing. And then we're like totally drenched in sweat and walking down the Quasette and dancing. And getting home, and by the time we get back to the apartment, we were grumpy old ladies again. I'm so tired. I can't believe we danced.
It was so funny too, because there were so many of us just trying to get us all into parties and stuff.
Yeah,
once we did it, we had a blast once we got in, but it was like we were rolling like 15 deep. It wasn't that easy to get people on the
list.
That
is amazing.
We did family style.
We did.
And then the other thing that I love that we did is those kinds of things can be very expectational.
Yeah.
And you can sometimes be so tense or so expectational that you miss the actual experience. It's as if somewhere along the line we all kept each other in the now.
Yeah.
We were so grateful. We kept each other appreciative of everything that was going on around us. It was, you know, we went out and ate crepes together, remember Chan, and you know, and lemon ices on the Quasette, and it was like we didn't let it be about the competition, and we didn't let it be about the snotty French vibe. It was about being in this amazing famous place, being unknowns, being unrecognizable. And then by the third screening, I'm walking down the street one day down the Quasette and somebody in a cafe.
And I'm like,
yes, do I know you? Oh my God. Uh-oh, that was weird.
Because of her hair, they recognize her.
That was very weird.
You stand out.
Yeah, you stand out a bit, Krisha, just a bit.
So that was also the beginning of that for all of us. And people would come to talk to me and then they'd look at her and they'd do the, and they go, oh, her!
Yeah.
You know, you talk to people who are like big stars. Well, they don't even notice that stuff anymore because for us, this is like a very interesting, pivotal time in our lives.
They do.
Do they? Okay, good to know.
I mean, there's some of them that get to the point where they kind of figure out how to manage it that way, but a lot, particularly the younger actors, actresses in particular, very sensitive to the fact that people are staring or
I don't know that you ever
would get used to it.
We're huggers though, you know, that's the thing. We were having
But this for us it's like a couple people. For these people it's like every single
person. I wouldn't want to hug 5,000 of people. That would be awful. That wouldn't be good.
Yeah.
No.
But that would be awful.
No, I have a couple notices fine.
Yeah.
Just to remind you everything's okay.
We'll be in touch.
Yeah, that was Can. Can was amazing. And then Trey went to, you were at DeVille when we went to DeVille.
Yeah, we got to travel the world with it. It was amazing.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
Yeah, you went everywhere.
So you guys are now almost a year,
almost exactly,
beginning of this adventure. Does it feel like a year now, or does it feel like, are you ready for it to end and move on to the next thing, or does it feel like
I am personally, like, I just want Krisha to get out there because it's been so long.
Okay,
but at the same time. The movie. But at the same time, it did kind of fly by.
Like it flew.
Yeah.
It's just surreal, really. It's hard to wrap your head around all that's
gone
on.
We're premiering on March 18th. We premiered at South by March 16th. We won the award on March 17th. It's like very, you know, it's pretty cool. It's like a full loop around.
And will you worry on opening day? Will you be worrying about numbers and things like that? We're past that.
We're past that.
Yeah. We're not involved in that.
I'm sure he's not going to do much, I don't think.
Let's just say we don't have a lot of back half on this thing. Yeah. You know, so it's like, you know.
But seriously, we just did what was that called? A commentary. And the person that was, what's that called?
The engineer.
That recorded the sound for the sound.
Okay, he'd never seen our movie. Okay, so we do this commentary and we go through it. He comes in the room and he's like, wow. And he starts telling us his story of a person in his life.
His name will be on things, so don't get too specific.
Okay. Well, anyway, it touched him, and that's the point.
He was moved.
So
he had tears.
That's all we really care about. His eyes. He was touched, and he was moved. He had no expectations. So that's how kind of we feel, and that's not just a thing to say. That's really true. We really love it when people feel something from it, and if it moves them in any direction, that's great.
Yeah, and we've met people who are deeply moved by deeply it, moved. And if you know, the movie can just get out there to more people like that, that's all we
great.
Want.
And then the people that don't like it don't have to watch it, because people leave. Exactly. We've seen a lot of people get up and leave.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, and I've had people say, I had to leave a little bit and then I came back.
Yeah.
But I just couldn't do it. I couldn't take it anymore and I had to get out of there.
Or some people are, just
some people just don't
wait
like
till
it
comes, like, look at people are going to be the worst movie ever.
Yeah.
Made no sense.
You got to just let go of that stuff.
Yeah. We're trying not to care about that.
Yeah, don't read the comments.
Yeah.
That's
exactly. Don't ever.
So, and is there a Krisha population out there now? Are you feeling this? You're a professional actress?
I always was, but now I'm outed as one. I am, I'm having some meetings while I'm here, and I've turned down a couple things that didn't fit with my vision of the universe. And I'm one of those old-fashioned people that I feel like if a person has any visibility at all, that there's a kind of a obligation that the projects that they're in or choose or whatever should be more than just like escapism, or they should maybe have some message or some value to the planet or the people on it. And so I'm going to stick with that, because if I get work, I get work. And if I don't, I go back to Mexico and have my really sweet, low key, very zen, peaceful life there. And so I, being 65, I could never have said that when I was like, when I was first here, when I was 26, it was 30 years ago I gave up on LA and bolted and lived a really wonderful, amazing life full of joy, not full of the business, full of joy. And now I'm like back with the business and I'm ready to just tell people to fuck off.
Are you, if they call you and they want you to be the, you know, the funny gray haired lady?
No, it's more evil.
She's gotten, I'm getting offered for horror movies.
I'm getting offered slasher movies, like being really mean, evil, horrible people.
So just how I see you.
Yeah,
no, that's not on. That's just
yeah.
So well, actually, the thing is, the movie hasn't come out yet. No one's seen
it. Released.
So, like, and I don't think people realize how different Krisha is from her character too. Like, she's a sweet, free-loving hippie, and in the movie, I mean, I think people immediately assume she is the character. It's the name of the movie is Krisha. Her name's Krisha. But she loves dogs. She doesn't drink. She's, I just want the movie to get out there.
I saw the movie, so I've always assumed you're funny. Yeah. And you're,
thank you.
Character.
Exactly.
And exactly. Like, I can see you playing the, the boss at the, in the sitcom.
Anything benign. I'm good with benign. I'm good with benign, even if it doesn't have a message. I just, if I'm going to be a murderer, I want to know that there's a backstory. I want to know that we're going to understand what drove this person to be this person. I'm not into, like, things without a story. I mean, it's like there's a lot of media that's made just because they can, just because they know they're going to make a shit pile of money. You know, it's like he's not going to care about that. We didn't raise him to care about, the numbers. He's going to care about the film he made, the quality of the film, and I'm the same way. And Robyn, if Robyn gets back in front of a camera, she's going to want to know that what she's doing has an effect on people beyond just, they paid $7 or whatever.
So you're willing to play Nurse Ratched, but you're not really willing
to play. Oh my God, I would kill for Nurse Ratched. Are you kidding?
But that's the role different. She got stuck playing afterwards, you don't want to play those.
So
there you go.
Flowers in the attic.
As my manager said to me, we can turn down all we like and we can wait for better roles. And then don't worry, you can always pick up the knife later.
That sounds like him. Pick up the knife later.
He's like, that stuff is easy. I can do that anytime.
Keep her away from the shower.
Yeah.
That's right. Particularly in camp.
I'd be able to get in there anyway. The house I'm renting in Mexico right now, one of the most exciting things was that it had a big bathtub.
You can get in.
I sent Robyn a picture of me in the bathtub. Like, my ass fits in this tub.
It's in here.
This is not like a French tub for little skinny French asses.
And are you working on your next script? Or
yes. Luckily, A24, who's releasing Krisha, they did like a two-picture deal thing. So they're releasing that and funding and releasing my next movie. So that script's done, except like I continue doing little tweaks.
So do you have Scarlett Johansson or Alicia
Vikander? Which one? No.
They're too small.
Ben Mendelsohn. A24 staff.
He's going for Hillary Clinton.
Yes.
sure. Yes. She has some time.
Yeah.
I don't know if she'll have some time after. Hopefully. Unless Bernie. Anyway, hold on to the conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're already on your way with that.
Yeah, starting the casting process now, and budget and scheduling, and we're going to shoot sometime this year, so.
And will you shoot anywhere around your home, or will you be shooting in a real studio somewhere?
No, not a studio, definitely.
not allowed to come back to my house.
Yeah,
they
not.
Pay you. They can pay you a lot more.
Well, maybe. Yeah, I got nothing out of the last one.
No, just in the woods in the middle of nowhere. We don't know where that's going to be. Probably upstate New York or something.
But there are no goats in it, don't worry.
There are goats.
There are goats. Oh. Trey loves goats. He has a thing for goats.
I love goats.
I don't mean that.
But they're not
that.
Demonic
don't
goats.
Don't spread that
no,
word.
Not demonic, yeah. No.
And Krisha will not be popping out and killing anybody.
No, no. Yeah.
We'll see. Maybe.
Now that you've told him.
You're giving me ideas now.
Yeah, I come with a new idea.
I bring my own knife.
She'll bring the knife.
There you go.
And you guys don't want to do your own like talk show and
sure we will.
If we get the right offers, then
spoken by the therapist.
I'll just quit my practice. Yeah. I'm up for anything.
We'll do anything if you have a good pitch and you come to us and we feel sorry for you.
Yeah.
Well, you seem like a reality show waiting to happen. It seems like, you know.
Okay, you know what?
You know what?
I would watch it.
I will get right up and walk out of this room.
He meant it as a compliment.
I am totally serious. Do not do the Kardashian family analogy thing, because we are so much more crazy than that.
So they can't hold a...
No, yeah. There it goes. Yeah. And I don't have to have that stuff shot into my butt to have a butt like that, you know? I don't think any of them could block up a French bathtub without help.
Probably not.
I can't speak to that.
Yeah.
I actually have a lawsuit.
Yes.
I mean that is, I really can't speak to that. Yet.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
Well, thank you guys for coming out.
Thank you.
Like,
thank
I got, you know, like the DVD extras right here.
Yeah. Yeah.
The family that makes movies together.
Thank you very much. Beautiful. It's good to see you.
And I'm glad you're feeling better.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, man.
I'm glad you're feeling better. Oh.